really nice to be here with you this evening. Thanks for coming out. I look forward to sharing with you the future of healthcare and the internet. And I'm going to start with the big picture. And the big picture is we're still in the very early days. Not too long ago, I was saying that the internet had reached infancy. I guess now I would have to say it's an adolescent. It can walk, but it's still kind of weak-kneed. We have a long way to go. Power of the internet is awesome. It's a grassroots phenomena where people can express what they want and when they want it in the terms of and conditions under which they want to operate. It's all the power of the click or the tap of a device. Expectations are rising by the day. Every day we see something new possible on the internet, and it makes us scratch our head and say, why do I have to fax this form? Why are they only open 9 to 5? Why do I have to go there in person? There's a lot of questions that we begin to ask ourselves. Disintermediation is at the early stages also. This is the phenomena that happens when iTunes comes along and disintermediates all of the music industry. And those of us that have been close to it know that music was, that was the easy part. Now we see books, movies, Hollywood, and yes, even healthcare. So the big news is that healthcare and the internet are going to be the biggest merger of all time. And that's what I'd like to speak with you about. But first, a little bit more about the internet. I call it the pervasive internet. Millions of businesses, billions of people. And what might not be so obvious is trillions of things. Things. Anything that's electronic. Anything that has a chip in it will be connected to the internet. And everything will be connected to everything. Now, this is a horrifying thought to the security team and the CIOs of the world. But I am confident that we will, in fact, have the security and the privacy that we all expect. Coming along with this, trillions of things and billions of people, is an unimaginable amount of data. And we're going to talk a little bit more about that. First, just a bit more about this concept of the power of the click, the enormous power of the individual. One way they express themselves is, of course, through websites. And I have to say that there are a lot of websites that still are what you might call lame. The airlines are getting a little better. The banks are getting a little better. AT&T and Verizon are terrible. The average website is really not very effective. You click on something, it doesn't do anything, or it doesn't do what you want it to do or what you expect it to do. But one website, at Amazon.com, somehow seems to have mastered the point, which is the power to the people. They are just trying to empower us to buy things. They're not trying to be fancy or glitzy with their website. They just make it work. Now, the result of this is rather amazing when you think about it. The retail economy in the U.S. is about $4 trillion. And of that $4 trillion, a little less than $200 billion is what we would call e-commerce, e-retail commerce, e-tailing, some people call it. So a little less than $200 billion, that's what people bought on the web. And of that $200 billion, one company did $57 billion. Now, some of that was outside of the US, some of that was not for books and things and clothes, and it was for services and so on. But no matter how you look at it, roughly 10 to 15% of all of e-commerce was done by one company. How many retailers are there? About 4 million. And one of them did 10 to 15% of the business. How could they do that? Well, have you ever run into a disgruntled customer of Amazon? I never have, since I've been buying from them since 1995. They really understand the concept of power to the people when it comes to internet. Now, what about healthcare? Do they understand what we're looking for? When you think about how easy it is to do things on Amazon.com, and then you think about a prescription where a doctor diagnoses you and decides you need a certain medication, and they take a piece of paper and a pen and they scribble. And you take that scribble to the pharmacy, and the pharmacy looks at it and says, huh? Sometimes they guess what the physician meant. Sometimes they guess wrong, and people die. Thousands of people die every year due to medication errors, mostly related to information errors. So e-prescribing is obviously something that we desperately need, and I think people are beginning to realize this. People are going to demand it, and in fact, I think the healthcare revolution is just now underway. More to say about that in a moment. So first, I'd like to give you sort of a broad brush of what I see happening in healthcare, and then we're going to dive a little deeper about what the future may have in store for us. Massive changes are underway in healthcare. Massive changes. People say it's a really bad system. It seems impossible to get it right. And I can only say to you, it is changing very rapidly. We're beginning to move into an era of patient-centered medical care. This first concept here, patient-centered medical home, is not a place. It's a concept, it's an approach, it's a process by which a physician coordinates your care. That's what patient-centered medical home means. It means coordinating your care so that when you go to a specialist, that specialist knows why you're there. And when the specialist has a question of the primary care physician, they can get the answer. They all have the same data. They're all working together like a team to make us healthier. Healthcare information exchanges will be the method by which physicians and hospitals and other providers will be able to exchange data about us. Now, some people say, I don't want anybody to have my data. Well, if you want to be healthy, you do want them to have your data. You want it to be safe, you want it to be secure, but the sharing of the data is the major thing holding back more effective and more cost-effective healthcare. Home health monitoring is a huge, huge opportunity. About 3% of Medicare's reimbursements are for home health care. I would say it should be 30%. I don't know, maybe 40, maybe 25, but not 3. And there is so much that can be done at home, and we're going to talk a little bit more about that. Integration with clinical devices. You know, a hospital is always getting new pieces of equipment. There is an infinite number of medical devices that hit the market every year. And those devices are creating data. Now, where does that data go? Does that data get shared among all of the people that are taking care of you? Does that data go into your electronic medical record? And I would have to say, in most cases, it does not, but it certainly can and will. And microarrays, this is a technical concept whereby a little sample of your DNA can yield incredible insight about markers in your human genome that may have something to do with a particular condition you have, and that information can then be matched against other medications that might have an impact on that same gene and can lead to a cure. We'll have a little bit more to say about that. The big picture here is what I would call population health. Population health. Today, physicians are compensated to see us. The more they see us, the more they're compensated. That model is going away. That model is moving into what we call accountable care. And accountable care is a concept whereby physicians are compensated for you to be healthy, not to be sick. And this accountable care is based on a population. So a hospital might get a certain number of dollars per person per zip code to take care of the people in that zip code. So if they get a fixed amount of money to take care of that number of people in that population, are they going to be motivated to have you keep coming back? No. They don't want you to come back. They're going to do everything they can to keep you from coming back. They're going to call you and say, how's it going? Today, they don't do that. You get discharged from the hospital and you're on your own in some cases. This is changing, of course, right now. But when you move to a population-based approach, big changes are in front of us. Speaking of big, you've all heard about big data. This is, if you haven't heard about it, you will see it in USA Today and all the magazines and all the newspapers are going to be talking about the flood of big data. Trillions of tweets and billions of emails and all forms of data that are being generated by our iPhones and our iPads and various sensors that are producing data and bringing that into the cloud, which we're going to talk more about. And this data is very important from a business perspective, but what about healthcare big data? Well, healthcare has a lot of big data also. Mobile streaming of data about our health. Streaming directly from us into our electronic medical record to provide data about us. Continuous monitoring for chronic illness. Chronic illness is where most of our expenditures for healthcare reside. And if there's a way we could monitor people, and instead of waiting 30 days, have them come back to the doctor's office, if we could continuously monitor people, we might be able to anticipate an impending problem and be able to intervene and prevent that readmission to the hospital. Personalized health is going to be a reality. Personalized health, you know, take one of these for 30 days and come back and see me. That one size fits all approach is really not the future of healthcare. The future of healthcare is to have a prescription that is unique to your DNA, unique to your condition and your DNA. And ultimately, we will have digital models of our lives so that supercomputers will be able to simulate our particular condition and simulate the possible effect of a particular drug and find out if it's a match, and if so, what the dosage of that should be. So these are sort of big changes that we can expect in healthcare. Now let's talk about the future, and I'm going to discuss this along these seven axes: fast, always on, everywhere, natural, intelligent, easy, and trusted. These seven characteristics I've found make it easy to parse all the things that are going on in sort of an organized way to talk to it. It's somewhat arbitrary. Let's start with fast. Well, the internet it's fast, but it's a lot faster in other parts of the world, unfortunately, than it is here. If you rank the availability of broadband, high-speed internet service, the U.S. ranks about 15th in the world. This is not a pretty picture. It's getting better, but it's not getting better fast enough, and that's because we don't have enough competition. It's really that simple. There are so many people that live in a certain place, and if that's where you live, then you get Comcast, or you get UVerse, or you get Verizon. You don't get a choice. And that lack of choice is what has led to very high prices and, frankly, much slower speeds than could be available. There are threats to net neutrality. This is another term you'll read about. Net neutrality is a concept that says if you have a connection to the internet, doesn't matter what provider it is, you can get access to everything that's on the internet. Well, not having net neutrality might be, for example, if Disney and Comcast made a deal whereby the only way you could get the Disney's content was to be a Comcast subscriber. That would not be net neutrality. That would not be a good idea. But I can tell you that kind of idea has surfaced many, many times, and this is why it's become a political issue, unfortunately. Now, when it comes to fast or speed, we need to comment a moment from a healthcare perspective about e-labs and e-imaging studies. E-labs. Let's talk about labs that we have today. We go to the doctor, and the doctor says, you need to get your blood examined. So you have a blood sample drawn from your arm. It goes to Quest or the Danbury Hospital Laboratory or any number of labs, and that blood is analyzed, and that analysis produces a lot of digital data about our blood. Now, what happens to that digital data? Well, we call the doctor's office and say, do we have the results yet for my blood test? No, we don't have the results yet. Okay, you call back at 1 o'clock. We're closed from 12 to 2. Do you know any other business that closes when most of the customers have time to come in and like buy something? They're closed. You call back at 4. Yes, the doctor has the information, but he hasn't had time to look at it. He'll call you. So the doctor calls you at 7 o'clock. You're okay. Oh, great. I'm okay. By the way, doctor, could I have a copy of this data about my blood? Sure. Just call the nurse in the morning and she'll fax it to you. So we have this analog information coming out of our arm. It becomes digital, and our healthcare provider converts it back to analog. Wouldn't it be nice to put that in a database? Anybody use Quicken? You know where every penny came from, where it went, where it is. What about your blood? Whose data is that? I can tell you there are doctors that think that that data is theirs. It's my blood. It's my data. Why can't I have it? Well, you can, but you have to demand it. A lot of hospitals and doctors, they say, well, if you want it, you have to drive here and come get it when we're open. You have to come sign a form before we can give you your data. So this is what I meant by this healthcare revolution. E-imaging. How long does it take to get the results of an x-ray or an MRI? How long does it take? Well, all I can tell you is it takes a lot longer than it needs to. Because as soon as you have that scan, that data is there, and it's your data. And does a doctor have to see it before you do? Well, there are some cases where you maybe want the doctor to explain it to you. You just don't really want to know. That there are cases, but that is the exception, not the rule. Many healthcare systems, when you have an imaging study, you get an email shortly thereafter that says, click here and you can see your results. It's of your data about your blood or about your imaging. So we have a long way to go there. E-prescriptions, by the way, that's happening. It's happening right across the street here at Danbury Hospital. We're fortunate to have a visionary hospital that's very advanced in these areas. It's still a relatively small percentage, but it's growing rapidly. E-prescriptions are a great thing. No longer does the pharmacist have to guess. But not only that, that medication, before it is dispensed, that medication is checked against all other medications that you're taking, including ones that were prescribed by other doctors, not just that doctor and not just that pharmacy. And it's checked against known allergies. And the name of that drug is compared against the dosage of that drug. There are a lot of drugs that have names that are very, very similar. And so one way to test that is to look at the dosage to see if it matches. So big progress is being made there. And in fact, e-dispensing now is available, where a person can return to a nursing home. And when they get there, there's a cart. It's like Horn and Hardart, if anybody's old enough to remember them, where you got food out of a dispenser. Yep, you put a few quarters in. Well, it's the same concept, that this machine physically dispenses the medication, instead of what happens today in many cases is you have to wait 3 or 4 days to get it. So then, of course, there's the smart ambulance. This is another part of speed. And when it comes to emergency medicine, speed is definitely what we want.
So technology has advanced incredibly over the last 15 years. When I first started out, we were writing patient care reports with pens and pencils. Now we're using computers, very advanced computers, with speed that is just incredible. It makes a tremendous difference when we're taking care of people. When a 911 call comes in, it goes through a computer and very rapidly scans all the available ambulances and picks the closest one to that address. And it takes into account time of day, traffic patterns, all kinds of information that we would have only been able to guess years ago.
Time is muscle. In the end, the longer a heart is deprived of oxygen, the more heart muscle is damaged, the higher likelihood that somebody will die.
One of the benchmarks that people have is how fast they can get to a cath lab when they have a heart attack.
Imagine this. Today, when you call 911 and you get in an ambulance and you get to the hospital is fantastic at determining your problem, putting you through a triage process, and getting the right care brought to bear. The concept you just saw here was one where by the time you get there, they already know an awful lot about you. They know what medications you're taking, they have seen your electronic medical record, they are ready to immediately jump into the care that you may need. Now, the second characteristic is always on. Let's talk about this. The pervasive wireless internet. Well, it's not quite pervasive yet. We're getting there. It's in all the Starbucks, 100% for Starbucks. Hotels that see it as a profit opportunity, they're very aggressive about this. When you think about it, does that really make sense? I mean, when you go to the hotel, you get water, you get electricity, you get heating, ventilating, air conditioning, and you don't get Wi-Fi unless you pay for it? I don't know, that never made sense to me. And it's not making sense to more and more hotels. They're realizing that people just expect it to be there. And frankly, in France, and the French were very slow to pick up on the internet. They actually were quite opposed, to put it mildly, when I was there in 1994 talking about the web for the first time in Europe. Now, the French are making us look like the slowpokes. You can get 100 million bits per second for $79 in France. They have Wi-Fi everywhere. They see it as an empowerment for their people. They see it as a partnership with utility companies to make connections to the internet something that all citizens should have. Now, I'd like to tell you a little bit about CardioNet. We talked about the concept of being able to monitor people. This is a concept that in some respects will give us cause for alarm. You know, like, do we want to be monitored? But if you look at the data, there are a lot of people who are chronically ill, and they need monitoring to prevent themselves spending a lot of time in the hospital, time after time after time, where people, sometimes they get called frequent flyers, you know, here they come again. Why are they coming back again? Well, because they weren't being monitored. Let's take a look.
Patients prescribed CardioNet wear three leads attached to a sensor. The sensor sends ECG information about every heartbeat to a small portable monitor. When the monitor detects an abnormality, it automatically sends the ECG information to the CardioNet Monitoring Center. Certified monitoring technicians analyze the data, respond to events, and report data to physicians.
So this is extremely exciting, what's being made possible by CardioNet and others that have a similar concept. Right now, there's a study underway at Danbury Hospital right across the street. It's actually a study that I'm very personally involved in. I'm working on a doctorate in healthcare myself. And we have a study that's underway monitoring patients with this pendant that you saw around the neck. We have only 6 patients in it so far, but we hope by the end of the summer to have 130 patients, 65 of which will not have monitoring, 65 of which will. And we're going to find out if this telemonitoring and an alert to a cardiologist and an intervention can prevent that patient from going back into the hospital. This is $30 billion a year the government spends for readmissions. And the government has said, we're not going to pay for those anymore. If they're coming back within 30 days, which 25% of them do, then there must be something the hospital's doing wrong. Well, that's not exactly the case, but there's more the hospital can do, and monitoring is a big piece of that. So I'm enthusiastically looking to see how this study is going to go. Now, this pendant that you saw samples the heart 250 times per second. Can a computer keep up with 250 times per second, times lots of patients, thousands of patients, tens of thousands of patients being monitored? Well, let's put this in perspective. Some of you may be old enough to remember this computer. This was built by a gentleman named Seymour Cray. It's called the Cray 1 supercomputer. It was introduced in 1976. Costs about $5 million, weighs about 5 tons. It doesn't come with any apps. It doesn't play music. It can't even make a phone call. All right, along comes the iPhone. And if you look at the power of this device compared to an iPhone 4S, guess which one is faster? You guessed it right, the iPhone. So the potential for monitoring healthcare of individuals by individuals is quite large. Let's take a closer look at that. Here's a company called AliveCore. AliveCore makes a sensor which fits on the back of your iPhone. So you hold your iPhone like this with 2 fingers on each side, you press the button, and this monitors your heart. And in 30 seconds, gives you the equivalent of a 12-lead ECG. The data is stored on your iPhone. You can annotate it. I wasn't feeling well when this happened, etc. Your physician can review it. And some people say this could replace 75% of echocardiograms. Now, echocardiograms are lucrative for hospitals and for physicians, but do we really need all of them that we get? Could this be more effective as a screening tool? Does it replace the doctor? No. Does it replace really serious formal testing? No. But can it be used for screening to determine who really needs a more intensive test? And the answer is absolutely yes. Well, there are other devices coming along in this with the same concept. Let me show you one I find quite interesting.
Each day, millions of Americans carry and use inhalers to relieve asthma symptoms. How often a person uses their inhaler indicates how well their disease is managed. The Asthmapolis sensor is a small device that attaches easily to most inhalers. It automatically determines the time and location when the inhaler is used, because revealing where people use their inhalers provides valuable clues about environmental exposures that cause attacks.
So this is a really big deal. Asthma care costs around $60 billion a year. Millions of people have this, large numbers of children. This device, this is very exciting. Every time someone inhales, that device captures the latitude, the longitude, and the action that that person took of inhaling. That data goes into a cloud environment. It gets merged with the CDC database in Atlanta, and this allows providers and healthcare planners to identify areas of high concentrations that are going to cause problems for people that have asthma. IBM has a team of data scientists. This is a new job term. It didn't used to exist. What's a data scientist? You know, we didn't have those even a few years ago. Well, this is a big thing now, data scientists. And they're working with the city of Louisville, Kentucky, which has a high degree of asthma conditions. And they're focusing on how can we notice it? How can we determine the concentration? How can we alert people that this is a bad area that you don't want to be in if you're subject to asthma attacks? And of course, ultimately leading to cures. Well, we can't talk about always on without talking a little bit about TV. A company called Boxy, this has nothing to do with healthcare, but Boxy has a vision that we could do a lot better with TVs and make it more open and easy to use. Why is this a problem? Here's why.
Well, that's right around Arizona, New Mexico, Kentucky, Colorado. More than
that, about a half hour. All right, thank you. You know, there are two sides to a concert ticket. One side says scalpers shouldn't be judging the prices, but then the other side that says you should be able to resell your ticket if, say, somebody comes down sick and you can't go. And your eyes are not deceiving you. Coming up, you will see a
Well, he's right. It is ridiculous. Some people have 6 or 8 or 10 remotes. Most people have, if you watch movies, most people have at least 3. These 3 devices have 153 keys. 153. Even a kid could not figure out how to work these. That's the norm. And along with that is this device. This is the Apple TV remote. It has 3 buttons. 3 buttons. Why does it take Apple computer to figure out what Comcast should have been able to figure out 30 years ago instead of the interface that we get from them, which is frankly impossible to use? This is the interface of the Apple TV. Do you think you could figure out how to find something of interest here? Of course, it is so easy, so intuitive. So we're going to see big changes ahead in TV. Okay, let's talk about everywhere. So where is the internet anyway? I still marvel when I hear people say, I'm going to go check that on the internet. And when I hear that, I'm thinking, where are they going to go? Well, we know where they're going to go. They're going to go to their PC, because for most people, that's where the internet was. I say was because now we know where the internet is. It's in our pocket or in our purse. It's where we are. This is a big, big change to have the internet be where we are. Now, this is of great interest, this subject of mobile or mobile, if you're in Europe. It's of big interest because of the numbers. There's about 1 billion computers in the world. That includes tablets. There are about 5.6 billion cell phones, paid cell phone contracts in place. So this is why it's such a big deal. Now, since iPhone and Android got us all interested in smartphones, we've begun to see some really big changes. By the way, that 5.6 billion phones today is probably 30% smartphone, 70% dumb phone or not smartphone. Those numbers are going to flip within less than 2 years, I would say. And it's making possible some really interesting things. Let's talk about them. First one is Fitbit. Some of you in the audience, I'm sure, have a Fitbit clipped onto your wallet or in your purse. I carry mine in my pocket. It counts your steps. It counts how many stairs you climb. When you reach your goal, you get a badge by email. Congratulations, you got 70,000 steps this week. And then, of course, you can step on your Fitbit scale, and it measures your weight and your body mass index. And as soon as it captures that measurement, it goes up to the cloud. It synchronizes through your iPhone. You can go to the website or just use your iPhone or iPad, and you can see your record, your challenges, your accomplishments. It's really great. Now, could this have healthcare implications? Well, of course. We know that exercise is a key ingredient to prevention of many serious diseases and also part of the cure. And then we have something called IEMs. Anybody ever have an IEM? This is an ingestible event marker. An ingestible event marker is all about pills. Pills are, of course, a great thing. They cure people. It's a miracle what some pills can do. For people that have chronic diseases, one of the issues is they don't take their pills. I remember some years ago, my mother was prescribed a certain pill, and she didn't like the color of it, or the size of it, or the taste of it. And, Mrs. Patrick, did you take your pill? Oh, yeah, I took it. It was in the wastebasket. She didn't take it. She didn't like it. She wouldn't take it. And this, unfortunately, is an issue. Well, a company called Proteus has designed a very small chip that actually attaches to a pill. And the way the system as a whole works is that these pills that have a tiny chip in them, when they reach their stomach and the gastric acid does its chore, as soon as the acid hits that sensor, that little blue Band-Aid, which you wear on your abdomen, it's just like a Band-Aid, it has a sensor in it. It picks up a signal from the pill, and it updates your record on your iPhone or perhaps on the website of a caregiver, a family member, who says, Mom, you didn't take your pill. Now, some people don't like this idea. I can understand that. But again, chronic illness in this country can bankrupt us if we don't find better, more effective ways to deal with it. One more, LumoBack. This is great.
Lumo is great. It's designed to tell you what your pelvis and lower back are doing. When you sit, we want you to strive for sitting in an upright position with your pelvis neutral like this. As I start to slouch with my pelvis and lower back, Lumo knows.
Now, I don't have to tell you how big a toll lower back pain takes on our economy, on our morale, on our quality of life. I met the gentleman that you were just listening to at a conference in San Jose. Talk about entrepreneurship. A young person with an MBA and an MD. And he was very interested in this problem of the lower back, and he devised this thing called LumoBack. It's like a Band-Aid, and you put it right in your lumbar lordosis, right there in the curvature of your back. And when you aren't standing straight or sitting properly, you get a little vibration comes through that sensor. And it keeps track and shows you a log so that you can see what your behavior was during the day, and you might learn what your good times and bad times are so that you can do something about it. Well, now, I just have a small segue, a sidebar here about the iPad. I always get asked about the iPad, and so I'm going to proactively make a couple comments about it before we continue the journey here of what's ahead. So the PC had its day, I would say. Are they dead? No, they're not dead. If you're a content creator and you like a big screen for your spreadsheets and your artwork and graphics and movies and game creation, you know, they're not going to go away anytime real soon. But for most people, a tablet is quite adequate. And in fact, for reading newspapers and magazines and journal articles, I would say it's superior, not only superior to the old way, but even superior to a Kindle. A tablet is a really great thing when you hold it in your hand. It's location aware. It can watch you. It has two cameras. And some people say, I don't know if I want to be watched. Well, you can turn it off. You don't have to be watched. But, you know, there's two sides to this story. Does anybody remember Rodney King? I believe it was early March of 1992 in Los Angeles when Rodney King was being beaten by policemen in Los Angeles, and there was a hobbyist with a big camera on the top of the roof of the building next door filming this. So when people worry about the government watching us, I always say to myself, well, yeah, the government might be watching me, but I can watch the government too. So there definitely are two sides of the story. I would say tablets are going to dramatically change the way people live their lives. When you look at Apple's report yesterday, their quarterly report, some people said, oh, what a disaster. Well, they're looking at profit margins and some financial numbers, but if you look at what they're actually doing, they sold 20 million iPads in 90 days. Compared to 11 million the prior year's quarter. So people are adopting tablets that would not adopt a PC. Why? Because it's simple. It's simple. You lift the lid and it's on. If I had a laptop here instead of this iPad, I would be sitting there just nervous as could be, knowing that that PC was going to shut down or time out. And people say, you know, push this button, push that button, and you have to have it plugged in for power. This can sit here for 12 hours and I don't need to plug it into power. So tablets are appealing to people that previously were intimidated by what they see with the PC. And of course, healthcare records, what a great thing to have in your iPad. I use Health Vault by Microsoft, and it's great. I have all my records there. And have you ever been to the doctor when you're getting your annual physical and say, let's see, what was your blood pressure last year? And it's flipping through the piece. Oh, I know it's in here somewhere. You know, I'll find it. Oh, excuse me, doctor, it's right here on my iPad. And it not only is the data here, but I can show you the timeline. I can show you the mean and standard deviation of my blood pressure over the past 10 years. And this is part of the empowerment. And I say no more skeletons. You know the skeletons that hang in doctors' offices? Well, there's a better way to do that. Let me show you the Muscle System Pro. I know of one orthopedic surgeon in the room who probably will like this. Let's take a look at the knee. Let me rotate that a little bit. I'd really like to see the kneecap. Let me grab a scalpel. Take away a little bit of those muscles. There we go, I'm getting close. Let's take away some more. Let's take away all of it. There we go. Now this idea of the e-bedside is potentially profound. So when the doctor comes to your bed with their iPad, they can explain to you, this is where you hurt. This is what I'm going to do so you're not going to hurt anymore. This is how I'm going to do it. This is just really, I find this very compelling. And of course, doctors are getting these left and right. Some hospital, Ottawa Hospital has 4,000 iPads in the hands of their providers. So it's really a big deal. So much for that. Let's get back to where things are headed. The next category is natural. Natural. So social networking, I've been saying for a long time, this is not about social. This is not about 11-year-old girls talking to each other on Facebook. This is about us. This is about people looking for a job, people that are looking to hire someone, people that are wanting to put together a collaboration, people that want to work on something together. That's what social networking is all about. You can only look at LinkedIn and see how their stock went from nothing to doubling and tripling because people are beginning to realize that social networking is the most effective way to find a job or to hire people. And user-generated content, we now take that for granted. That's another natural aspect of this. What do I mean here is think about YouTube. The number of, I used to keep track of how many billion movies get uploaded every week. The numbers don't matter anymore. It's infinite. It's just a continuous stream from people putting information into YouTube. And this information is useful information. You can pick almost any disease or surgery or condition you might have, and you can find someone who has been sharing something about it. In fact, I would say that blogging is a very powerful way to share experiences. You know, one of the great surgeries performed right across the street here is bariatric surgery. A bariatric surgery, that's a big decision. And who do you listen to about, should I have this bariatric surgery to lose 100 pounds? Of course, the surgeon would like to perform this, but what's it going to be like? Well, they find out through social media. In fact, the hospital has been great at spurning that, you know, and creating social media capabilities within the hospital website to allow patients to be able to share. In fact, e-referrals, I call them, is a big deal. And I'm going to tell you about a site called Patients Like Me. This is sort of like Facebook, but instead of 600 million people, it's only a couple hundred thousand people. But it's a couple hundred thousand people who have 1,600 diseases in common. Listen to what the gentleman has to say.
So Patients Like Me is an online community created in 2006 by a family affected by ALS, or motor neuron disease. And they really wanted to try and share their experiences of what treatments worked, what treatments didn't, and which symptoms they could try and modulate. And the idea was if they were going through this trial and error process, well, there must be hundreds and thousands of other families going through this too.
Exactly right. That's the point. There are lots of other people that have exactly the same thing, and wouldn't it be nice to be able to exchange ideas with them to find out what medications are working from them, what providers do they see, how is it working. Let's go to the next one, intelligent. intelligent. Well, of course, there's a lot of intelligence behind the web, but the web itself is basically a bunch of documents. And you can click on them, and it'll take you to another document. But wouldn't it be nice if these web pages were actually smart? So if you saw a web page that said there's going to be an Eagles concert on this Friday night at the Ives Concert Hall, then those words each mean something. Eagles is a group. They perform music of a certain genre. The Ives Concert Hall is a place, and it's affiliated with a certain university. And Friday night happens to be April 26th. And so you put all that together, that means these web pages gain intelligence, and web pages can talk to each other without people having to be in the middle, so that contracts can be negotiated between a buyer and a seller automatically through the web. And of course, when it comes to healthcare, there's so much opportunity here in this subject of big data. If you are caring for a population of 100,000 people or 200,000 people, you're going to lose your shirt unless you know what condition those people have. And the more you know about them, the more you can help them, and the more you can provide prevention, you can provide clinics, you can target groups of people that have a certain condition, and you can design clinics just for them. Because if you design that clinic and they come and you encourage them, guess what? They're not going to come into your system for healthcare, and that's what you want as a healthcare provider. That's the only way we can close the gap. We're going to add 50 million more people into the mix. We're not going to add enough doctors to be able to provide for it. And of course, personal genomics, I mentioned that earlier. What about Watson?
This is Jeopardy, the IBM Challenge. Here are today's contestants. From Los Angeles, California, Brad Drucker. An IBM computer system able to rapidly understand and analyze natural language, Watson.
So we all know that Watson won. I can assure you that IBM didn't get into this to be able to say they won Jeopardy. They have much bigger ideas behind Watson. And it occurs in many industries, but the biggest one, the most important one, is in healthcare. Imagine if a primary care physician has a patient in the office and can pick up the phone and call Watson and say to Watson, I have a 47-year-old African-American female patient here that's taking the following medications and exhibiting the following symptoms. My initial diagnosis is this. The history of this patient has been the following. What do you think, Watson? And in the next, one or two seconds, Watson reads 100,000 medical journals that are applicable to that particular condition, reads the physician notes of the last million or two people that were treated with that particular condition for that particular kind of a person. So pretty good chance Watson could come up with some good ideas, and it's being deployed right now at Sloan Kettering in some very complicated areas of cancer. Time will tell if it's as effective as it could be, but I'm pretty sure it will be. Well, next to the last is easy. Easy. When's it going to get easier? Well, tablets has a big effect here. When you think about an iPad or an Android tablet, and you think about how you turn it on or turn it off, you know, you just open the cover and it's on. You close the cover and it's off. How do you turn off your Windows PC? Step one is you click the Start button. Huh? You want to print something, you click on File. Huh? So then you go and you decide, I am going to shut this down. And it says, do you really want to shut this down? And you say, yes. And then it says, you can't shut it down because there's something going on that you don't understand. You're an idiot, and we're not going to shut down. The iPad, you close the lid, and it's off. So consumer electronics and people like Apple and Google with Android know that things can be, they don't have to be complicated. They actually can be simple. We have a new thing coming along called web apps. And I won't bore you with the details of this, but only to say that there's a new protocol of the way the World Wide Web works that's going to, I think, have very big impact. You know, for a long time, we didn't have iPads and iPhones. We had web apps. And web apps were like airline reservations or banking or various things, and we learned how to use them. But when apps came along with the iPhone and the iPad, and there are millions now of these apps, there's something about an app that makes it easier. What is it? Well, it's because it doesn't have all the file and print and all that stuff cluttering up the screen. It kind of has what we're there for, right? It's very oriented toward the job at hand, and it's simple. Well, now this new protocol coming along is going to enable apps to be created that will work exactly the same, whether it's on an iPad or an Android or an iPhone or a PC or a Mac or any kind of a computer or any kind of a device. It'll look exactly the same. This is a breakthrough in the world of standards, and we're going to see this over the next couple of years. Now, cloud computing. Now, there isn't time to do justice to the importance of cloud computing. I would say that it's a matter of everything's going to be in the cloud. You know, it used to be when you bought a new application, if you're running a business and you wanted to buy an accounts payable system or a payroll system, you would buy the software application from a company and it would come along with a computer. Do you really want that computer? No, you want that application. Well, cloud computing is booming because you can get the benefit from the application and you don't have to have any computers. You have to be able to connect to the internet with your tablets or with a PC, but you don't have to have the responsibility to roll out the infrastructure for the application. And this is why businesses are moving very rapidly into this. Amazon's fastest growing business is cloud computing, where they're renting part of their infrastructure to businesses, both large and small. Netflix actually uses Amazon, the cloud, to deliver movies. So Dropbox is one example, iCloud, of course, from Apple, Amazon, Google. I mean, there's lots of cloud computing. It is incredibly important in healthcare because we have all these electronic medical records and they're all different. So one doctor has Allscripts and another doctor has Sorian and another doctor has Cerner and all these different variations of electronic medical records that are sort of the same but not exactly the same. Well, we want our providers to be able to have access to our information. We want them to be able to share that for our benefit. How do we do that? And the answer is through the cloud. So eHealth is going to be a lot less paper, fortunately, and it's going to be better outcomes. Let me tell you about an interesting new startup along these lines.
Now you can stay healthy and feel better faster by booking doctor and dentist appointments through ZocDoc, the website that makes finding doctors and getting an appointment quicker and easier than ever before. ZocDoc lets you find doctors and make appointments right from your computer, 24/7. Just enter the type of doctor you want to see, your zip code and insurance, and instantly see a list of doctors and their open appointments.
It's ZocDoc. This is great. When I first learned about this 6 months or so ago, it immediately reminded me of what I hear all the time, which is there aren't enough primary care physicians. You can't find one. And if you find one, you can't get an appointment. Well, when I saw this, I went to ZocDoc.com. I live in Ridgefield. And I said, I'd like to see a primary care physician. You pick your insurance. I'm on Medicare, so I picked Medicare. When would you like an appointment? You click as soon as possible. You put in your Social Security number and some basic information. Boom, up pops a list of doctors that could see me within the next 24 hours. Even one that afternoon, some the next day, some on Saturday, some on Sunday. Who are these doctors? I don't know. I didn't recognize any of the names, but they're real doctors, right? That have not been able to promote themselves. So this concept of let's do healthcare the way we do Amazon, the way we do eBay, the way we do other things on the web. Why can't we do that in healthcare? Can't we be cool also? Yeah, we can. And this great hospital across the street is working with ZocDoc, actually, on a collaborative approach to see, you know, could we make this scale up for an environment where there are large numbers of physicians? Well, the last category is trust. Can we trust the internet? This is a real important question. It's a valid question. There are bad things happening out there. I can assure you that there's going to be a breach in healthcare. I hope it's not this hospital. I'm quite confident it won't be. But there's going to be some hospital that's, or some provider, some physician, some imaging laboratory service. There's going to be somebody that's going to cut corners. They're not going to take the sufficient security steps to make sure that our data is protected. There are very severe fines, penalties from the government if you violate healthcare information of an individual. Nevertheless, I can tell you what's going to happen, but that is not a reason to stop progress. That is not a reason to not be sharing data, because sharing data is the only way we can make healthcare work effectively. Privacy is, of course, a big issue. I don't think we yet really understand what privacy means in the broadest sense. Business processes are part of the trust model, too. Can you trust the organization you're dealing with? You know, when Bank of America put in place those fees for use of a debit card, their customers hated them. They really didn't like that. Do they trust the bank? Well, maybe not. So it's more than just security and privacy. It's also those business processes, and are they efficient? And people are going to start asking, you know, if everything is paper, and if the only way I can get this doctor to see me about my special need is for the other doctor to send 50 pages of faxes to them, should I trust those doctors? I mean, who has access to that manila envelope that gets transferred from the primary to the specialist? Who has access to that? We don't know who has access to it. It could be a 15-year-old student, a next-door neighbor's daughter that's working in that doctor part-time. So I would say it's not a sure thing, but I believe we should trust the internet. It's our best hope for healthcare. We should block the things that are bad with technology, not with laws. The laws don't work. You know, we have a do not call bill. Right. There's 18 exceptions in it. That's why it doesn't work. I can't imagine a bill that would be in fact, there was an attempted bill called Do Not Spam. And I testified more than once about why that was a really bad idea to pass legislation, because it would have been a nightmare of exceptions. So healthcare is aligning with patients. I mean, that's the other half of this question is, can we trust the hospital? Do we trust our doctor? Do we trust that they're giving us this service because we need it or because they need it? When efficacy studies come out and say, you know, the PSA test that men have been taking for many years, it is really an ineffective test. And the risks of taking the precautions that come out of a positive response exceed the risk of doing nothing for most people, certainly people my age. And yet you see in some hospitals posters where doctors are saying, you have a right to this. You have a right to get that test. You have a right to get that procedure. So we should challenge things. We should ask about price. We should ask about outcomes. Is the most expensive doctor the best doctor? Oh, I don't want to have my baby delivered by that doctor. They charge $1,500. The rest of them charge $20,000. The one that charges $1,500 might be better. We don't have the transparency today to be able to see what the costs are. We don't see even the outcome data, but we will. It's happening. You're more and more we're going to be able to say, well, before I get my knee replaced, I want to find out how many knees has this surgeon replaced. I don't want to be the third. So, yes, we can trust healthcare as we move forward. So how do you survive and thrive in this world? Well, what I advise people to do is think outside in. Listen to the people. Now, what do I mean by outside in? Well, it's the opposite of inside out. So the best example I can think of is the call center. So you dial the call center, and you get a message that says, please pay attention because our menus have recently changed. How could it be that every 800 number in the world all just recently changed their menus? How could that be? I got to update my postal code. It changed. Press 1 for English, 2 for Spanish. Okay. Press 3 for sales, 4 for service, 5 for the location of our nearest branch offices. Jeez, I just want to change my postal code. I want to talk to somebody. I don't really want to talk to somebody. I just want to get this job done, but I press 0. You have pressed an invalid key. How can 0 be invalid? Well, the other day I pressed 1, a 9, and I got somebody. Let me try that. 9. Thanks for calling. Goodbye. See, that's inside out. That's inside out. That's them driving us. We want to drive the process, and we should be able to. Please enter your 16-digit account number. You enter your 16-digit account number. Hi, this is Mary. How can I help you? I want to change my postal code. Sure, I'd be glad to help you. What is your 16-digit account code? I just entered it. Well, it doesn't appear on my screen. That every company has the exact same issue. You've all seen it. How can that be? It's because You know, power to the people hasn't gotten through to them quite yet. Think big and act bold. Start simple and iterate fast. The old days, we'd design a big system, a big solution, and then 18 months later, we'd turn it on. 18 months is an eternity when it comes to the web. You know, that's like 6 web years. And that old model just doesn't work. Anticipate the integration of the internet. When you think about data being available and shared among all the providers, yeah, there's some things to be concerned about. We need to be the ones that control. Yes, it's okay for my data to go from here to there. You have to be able to be in control of it. But assuming that you are, why wouldn't you want that? And this is what hospitals and physicians need to anticipate, is that this is the part of the solution for more cost-effective and better outcomes in healthcare. Get a taste of net attitude, I call it. Talk to kids and seniors, both of whom know a lot about this. And focus on health. It certainly is our future. Well, I'd like to conclude by inviting you to visit patrickwebb.com, where you can find everything I've ever said or done or written. There's a book I wrote about this subject generally that we're talking about called Net Attitude. You can subscribe to a service that will give you an email when I write a new story. I write about roughly something once a week. So now I'm going to invite you to offer your questions, and I'll hopefully have an answer or two. Yes, sir, we have some microphones here.
I can enunciate.
Okay, go ahead.
So what you're talking about here about the integration of internet into healthcare.
Right.
So GE's working on that, right, with their poorly thought out matrix.
They are.
What do you think about that? Yeah. Well, about their doings?
Yeah, GE's a great company. You know, they understand the idea of, thank you, of things. You know, they understand the idea of having smarts in a locomotive or a jet engine. They understand the idea of anticipating that this jet engine is not broken now, but it's going to be in the next 35 hours of flight time, so it's, you know, it's time to bring it in for diagnosis. Those same concepts apply to healthcare, and GE is very cognizant of that. So is Intel, so is IBM. So yeah, big companies are very focused on this. The challenge is that healthcare has software in lots of different silos. So you have the surgical department, and you have the emergency department, and you have this department and that department, the laboratory, imaging, and they each have systems, but they don't talk to each other. And here at Danbury Hospital, they have a great effort underway to tie them all together, to integrate all those silos so that it doesn't matter who you're seeing, your data becomes part of the overall system. Yes, sir. Okay, so there's a mic right behind you.
At the risk of opening up a political topic here, you did not mention anything about the Affordable Health Care Act. But what's your view on, does it help, does it hinder, is it moving in the right direction?
Yeah, well, the Patient Protection and Affordability Care Act has a lot of good stuff in it. Has a few bad things, too. And, you know, it has some taxes in there that a lot of people don't like. More than one. I mean, there's a lot of mischief in the, so far, only 15,000 pages of regulation. So the bill was 2,400 pages. On average, for every page of legislation, you get 10 pages of regulation. So when you go from a great concept in a bill that we want to implement accountable care, for example, then you turn it over to the bureaucrats to write 10 pages of how to do that. There's one part of the bill called meaningful use. It's an incentive for doctors and hospitals and providers to implement electronic medical records. This is a good thing. To meet this meaningful use criteria that they've established, very detailed criteria, you have to not just say you have it or not just have it, but actually use it in certain ways, in a very detailed way. Well, when that first came out, Jim and I and others at the hospital were scratching our head to say, you know, it sounds like a good concept, but how does it work? Well, a little later we found out. We got a package of information on just that one little subject of meaningful use, 900 pages long. And so you have to hire consultants and lawyers to try to peel it apart and figure out what does it mean. So there's that aspect of it clearly is a big government thing, but frankly, in the area of healthcare, we need some of that. You know, how can we sleep at night knowing we're the only developed country in the world that doesn't care for its population? The only developed country in the world. So, you know, of course, that's easy to say, who's going to pay for it? And because we can't agree on who's going to pay for it, we don't have it. So we say, well, we don't need to give these people health care because they actually have it, because a hospital cannot turn away a patient from the emergency room. Well, that's true. So we provide that care. We provide acute care, emergency care. What we need is preventive care. We don't provide that. So we're spending more because we don't do it right. So, you know, so what do I think of the ACA, the Affordable Care Act? I think there's a lot of really good stuff in there. And I think it is moving us in the right direction. It's providing a big challenge for a lot of hospitals. They're going to have to become more efficient, a lot more efficient. The old model doesn't work anymore. And there are, you know, many physicians and hospitals are, you know, I don't want to change. Well, you have to. And we should want them to. Yes, ma'am.
Can you talk about the financial issues of the disconnect between what what we receive as patients and healthcare providers and what the insurance companies don't have?
Yeah, well, there are a lot of issues there. You know, I gave a talk in Florida in March, very similar to this, and there was an orthopedic surgeon in the room, and he attacked me. And I said, I'm not from the Obama administration. You know, I don't set your rates. And he said, well, you mentioned that a hip costs $9,000. Do you think I get that $9,000? I said, no, I know you don't get it. He says, well, how much do you think I get for it? I said, well, I don't know, $2,500. He said, no, it's only $1,500. Okay, well, the bigger point is that under this accountable care model, the risk of doing something wrong is being shifted to the provider. So if a hip costs $9,000 to replace, more like $12,000 to replace, then the hospital's going to get $12,000, or let's put it this way, the accountable care organization gets $12,000 for that hip replacement. Now, where does that money go? Well, some of it goes to the surgeon, some of it goes to the hospital, some goes to the lab, to the imaging studies, to medications, to, you know, there's a lot of, it has to be split up in a lot of pieces. What happens if the hip gets infected and you have to go in again? Well, today, if the hip gets infected and you have to go back in, you get paid again. Tomorrow, you don't. You get that $12,000, and you better get it right, because if you don't, it's on your nickel. So that's a big shift. And so organizations that are dedicated and focused on quality, like Danbury Hospital is, Western Connecticut Health Network, is very focused on this. You know, they're going to come out ahead. Medicare is now withholding 1% of all reimbursements on a quarterly basis. They reallocate that 1%. By the way, 1% of $500 billion, you know, it's $5 billion. Next year it goes to 2%, the following year 3%. So that money's being withheld. It gets reallocated based on two things: quality metrics and patient satisfaction. Patient satisfaction has been unheard of in hospitals. We get paid for that? Yeah. Yeah, patients get a survey. Was your room clean? Was it noisy? Did the doctor explain what they were doing? Was the nurse friendly to you? Did you feel like you were being able to communicate? Did you consistently get all of your questions answered? Aren't they things we want? Absolutely. So hospitals now get compensated on it. And in the quality metrics, there's a lot of stuff in there. I used to be chairman of the quality committee at the hospital. We would review all these things every month, and they're very detailed things like, you know, hospital-acquired infections and falls and ventilator-associated pneumonia and readmissions of patients. So, you know, the alignment has not been proper in the past, but it's getting there. It's going to align so that we can trust the provider. The provider's going to do what's right for us. They're going to focus not on price the reimbursement per visit, but they're going to focus on our health. So it's a good thing. Yes, sir.
This is primarily a major culture change for people. So how do you see the timing, and how do you approach the problem of changing people's way of thinking?
Well, this is all about leadership. You know, the top person has to set the bar high and has to have a vision, like John Murphy, the CEO of Western Connecticut Health Network. He can explain all these things I've been talking about inside and out, 10 layers deep. He really is into this, and he's leading the team to change the culture. It has to change. The old way just isn't going to work. There's no more money. There's no more revenue. You know, the pie is going to get smaller, not bigger. So if you want to get your share of the pie, then you want to be efficient, and you want to have high quality. You know, quality, you read the stories in the paper, you can see it. It's, you know, bad things happen in healthcare, and those things cost a lot of money when they go wrong. So I think the alignment is good. Yes, sir.
John, why not mandate electronic medical records, since collectively we all pay for healthcare costs, and we're all facing the dilemma of how are we going to continue to pay for this going forward, and electronic records clearly would save money?
Yeah, well, some people would say it's not clear that you save money. I would agree that you do, but it's going to take time to gain those savings. The New York Times just had an article about this, saying that the experts that have been recommending electronic medical records, their study was funded by the people who benefit from it. But the reality is that the incentives provided by the government were so significant that every hospital and provider has started moving toward electronic medical record. They don't need to mandate it. They have, through the significance of the incentive. Yeah. So, and okay, one more in the back there.
This might be a big can of worms you might not want to address, but I appreciate you did. The whole issue that was recently brought to light with the big Time Magazine article about the bloat of charges at hospitals via the charge masters.
Right.
What's your thoughts on that?
Well, it's an antiquated system. You know, when you get a bill in the mail and it says on it, this is not a bill, and it says your MRI was $2,400, but $1,800 of that was not allowed, and $200 was adjusted, and your copay is $57, you scratch your head and you said, I don't know what it cost. It just doesn't, you can't make any sense of it. And that's, most people open the envelope and they throw the thing in the basket. It has to be revamped to make more sense. We need transparency into what things really cost so that we can make intelligent decisions. It's really that simple. It's a, you know, decades old system. It's going to change, I guarantee you. Well, I appreciate your questions, and feel free to send me an email, john@patrickwebb.com, if you had a question that I didn't